Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is When God Made Everything. Who made us? The Bible, God's Word, tells how the human race began. Long ago, God made the very first man and named him Adam. God made Adam out of the dust of the earth. When God breathed life into Adam, he came alive. He found himself in a beautiful garden called Eden. Before God made Adam, he made a beautiful world filled with wonderful things. Step by step, God made hilly places and prairie spaces, fragrant flowers and tall trees, brightly feathered birds and buzzing bees, wallowing whales and slippery snails. In fact, God made everything there is. Everything. In the very beginning, before God made anything, there was nothing except God. No people or places or things. Nothing. No light and no darkness. No up and no down. No yesterday and no tomorrow. There was only God, who had no beginning. Then God acted. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. Then God spoke, "Let there be light." Light. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. On the second day, God brought the waters of the oceans, seas, and lakes into order under heaven. On the third day, God said, "Let the dry land appear," and it happened. God also commanded the grass and flowers and shrubs and trees to appear, and they appeared in the evening and the morning were the third day. Then God made the sun and the moon and so many stars that nobody can count them, and the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Sea creatures and fish and birds were next on God's list. On the fifth day, he made big swordfish and tiny sardines, long-legged ostriches and happy little hummingbirds. God made every kind of fish to fill Earth's waters and every kind of bird to enjoy the land and sea and sky. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. After that, God spoke again. He said, "Let the earth bring forth living creatures, every kind of animal and insect and reptile came into being. There were earth-shaking elephants and busy beavers, mischievous monkeys and clumsy crocodiles, wiggly worms and cheeky chipmunks, gangly giraffes and purring pussycats. Every kind of animal was made by God that day. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. God did something else on the sixth day, something very special. Everything was now ready for man. There was food in the fields and animals to serve him. And God said, let us make man in our image. Let him be Lord over everything on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. God spoke to Adam, eat what you wish from the garden, but do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat from that tree, you will surely die. And the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make a helper for him. God brought all the birds and beasts to Adam. Adam named them all. He must have been very clever to do so. But among all the birds and beasts, there was no suitable partner for Adam. God brought Adam into a deep, deep sleep. Removing one of the sleeping man's ribs, God formed woman from Adam's rib. The woman God made was exactly right to be a partner for Adam. God made everything in 6 days. Then God blessed the seventh day and made it a day of rest. In the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, his wife, had perfect happiness obeying God. God was their Lord, their provider, and their friend. When God made everything, a story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 1 and 2. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. This Bible story tells us about a wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son, Jesus, to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins. So that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Do you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe Ideas by Sir O and click the notification bell for more videos. If you want to put a comment, please go to the comment section below. Thank you so much and have a good day. Again, this is Sir O. Have a nice day. Bye. Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is The Start of Man's Sadness. God made everything. When God made the first man, Adam, he lived in the Garden of Eden with his wife, Eve. They were perfectly happy obeying God and enjoying his presence until one day, did God tell you not to eat of every tree? The serpent asked Eve. We can eat of every fruit but one, she replied. If we eat or touch the fruit, we will die. You won't die, the serpent smirked. You'll become like God. Eve wanted the fruit of that tree. She listened to the serpent and ate the fruit. After Eve disobeyed God, she led Adam to eat the fruit also. Adam should have said, No, I will not disobey God's word. When Adam and Eve sinned, they both knew they were naked. Sewing fig leaves into aprons, they covered themselves and hid in the bush from God's presence. In the cool of the evening, God came to the garden. He knew what Adam and Eve had done. Adam blamed Eve. Eve blamed the serpent. God said, The serpent is cursed. The woman will have pain when children are born. Adam, because you sinned, the earth is cursed with thorns and thistles. You will toil and sweat to get your daily food. God put Adam and Eve out of the wonderful garden because they sinned. They were separated from the life-giving God. God made a flaming sword to keep them out. God made coats of skin for Adam and Eve. Where did God take the skins from? In time, a family was born to Adam and Eve. Their first son, Cain, was a gardener. Their second son, Abel, was a shepherd. One day, Cain brought God some vegetables as a gift. Abel brought some of the very best of his sheep as his gift to God. God was pleased with Abel's gift. God was not pleased with Cain's gift. Cain got very angry. But God said, If you do what is right, you will not be accepted. Cain's anger didn't go away. Sometime later in the field, he attacked Abel and killed him. God spoke to Cain, Where is your brother Abel? I don't know, Cain lied. Am I my brother's keeper? God punished Cain by taking away his ability to farm and making him a wanderer. Cain went out from the presence of the Lord. He was married to a daughter of Adam and Eve. They raised a family. Soon, Cain's grandchildren and great-grandchildren filled the city that he founded. Meanwhile, the family of Adam and Eve grew quickly. In those days, people lived much longer than today. When her son Seth was born, Eve said, God gave me Seth to replace Abel. Seth was a godly man who lived 912 years and had many children. In the world, people became more and more wicked as one generation followed another. Finally, God decided to destroy mankind and all the beasts and birds. God was sorry he had made man, but one man pleased God. This man was Noah, a descendant of Seth. Noah was righteous and blameless. He walked with God. He also taught his three sons to obey God. Now God planned to use Noah in a very strange and special way. The start of man's sadness. A story from God's word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 3 to 6. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119 verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know him. God knows we have done bad things, which he calls sin. The punishment for sin is death. But God loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask him to forgive your sins, he will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3 verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And by the way, if you want to share this video, please do so. You can share this to your friends and to everyone. If you want to put your comments, please do in the comments section below. Thank you so much and have a good day. Again, this is your Sir O. Till next time. Bye, children. Hey children, this is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is Noah and the Great Flood. Noah was a man who worshiped God. Everyone else hated and disobeyed God. One day, God said something shocking. I will destroy this wicked world. God told Noah, only your family will be saved. God warned Noah that a great flood would come and cover the earth. Build a wooden ark, a boat big enough for your family and many animals. Noah was ordered. God gave Noah exact instructions. Noah got busy. Probably, people mocked as Noah explained why he was making an ark. Noah kept building. He also kept telling people about God. Nobody listened. Noah had a great faith. He believed God even though rain had never fallen before. Soon, the ark was ready to be loaded with supplies. Now came the animals. God brought 7 of some species, 2 of others, birds, great and small, beasts, tiny and tall, made their way to the ark. Perhaps the people shouted insults at Noah as he loaded the animals. They did not stop sinning against God. They did not ask to enter the ark. Finally, all the animals and birds were aboard. "Come into the ark," God invited Noah. "You and your family," Noah, his wife, his 3 sons and their wives entered the ark. Then God shut the door. Then the rain came. A great downpour soaked the earth for 40 days and nights. Flood waters poured over towns and villages. When the rain stopped, even the mountains were underwater. Everything that breathed air died. As the water rose, the ark floated on top. It may have been dark inside, maybe bumpy, maybe even scary, but the ark sheltered Noah from the flood. After 5 months of flooding, God sent a drying wind. Slowly, the ark came to rest high in the mountains of Ararat. Now Noah stayed inside another 40 days as the water lowered. Noah sent a raven and a dove out of the ark's open window. Not finding a dry, clean place to rest, the dove returned to Noah. A week later, Noah tried again. The dove came back with a new olive leaf in its beak. The next week, Noah knew the earth was dry because the dove did not return. God told Noah it was time to leave the ark. Together, Noah and his family unloaded the animals. How grateful Noah must have felt! He built an altar and worshiped God who had saved him and his family from the awful flood. God gave Noah a wonderful promise. Never again would he send a flood to judge human sin. God gave a great reminder of his promise. The rainbow was the sign of God's promise. Noah and his family found new beginnings after the flood. In time, his descendants repeopled the whole earth. All the nations of the world came from Noah and his children. Noah and the Great Flood. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 6 to 10. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is God's Promise to Abraham. Long after the flood, people on earth made a plan. We will build a great city with a tower right up to the heavens, they said. Let's live together always. Everyone spoke the same language. God wanted people to live all across the world he had made, so he did something special. Suddenly, groups of people spoke differently. God gave them new languages. Those who spoke the same language moved away together. Perhaps people became afraid of others they could not understand. In this way, God caused people to feel different countries. The city they left was called Babel, which means confusion. Years later, in a place called Ur of the Chaldees, God spoke to a man named Abram. Leave this land, God commanded. Go to the land I will show you. Abram obeyed. God led him to Canaan. His wife Sarai and nephew Lot went with him. In Canaan, both Abram and Lot became rich. They had large herds of cattle. There was not enough pasture for so many animals. Lot's herdsmen quarreled with Abram's herdsmen. Let there be no trouble, Abram said. We will separate. Lot, you take first choice of the land you want. Lot chose a great grassy plain dotted with cities and villages. It looked good, but the cities were very wicked places. After Lot left, God spoke again to Abram. I give all the land of Canaan to you and your children forever. Abram and Sarai had no children. How could God keep his great promise? Three men from God came to Abram and Sarai. You'll have a baby soon, they said. Sarai laughed. She did not believe God's message. She was 90 years old. God told Abram he would now be called Abraham, which means father of many, and Sarai would be Sarah, which means princess. God also told Abram he would destroy the two wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Abram's nephew Lot lived in Sodom with his family. Lot believed God's warning when it came, but his daughter's husbands refused to leave Sodom. How tragic! They didn't believe God's word. Only Lot and his two daughters made to safety. Sadly, Lot's wife disobeyed God's warning and looked back as she ran. She turned into a pillar of salt. The Lord kept his promise to Abram and Sarah. They had a child in their old age, just as God had said. How they rejoiced when Isaac was born. Perhaps Abram also thought about God's promise to give him and his children the land of Canaan forever. God would keep that promise too. God always keeps his promises. God's promise to Abraham, a story from God's word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 11 to 21. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119 verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know him. God knows we have done bad things, which he calls sin. The punishment for sin is death. God loves us so much, he sent his son Jesus to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask him to forgive your sins, he will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And then, don't forget also to share this to your friends and loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Hey children, this is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is God Tests Abraham's Love. One night, God gave Abraham a strange command. It was a test to see if Abraham loved his son Isaac more than he loved God. take your son Isaac and offer him as a burnt offering. God commanded, offer Isaac, sacrifice his son. That was hard for Abraham. He loved his son very much. But Abraham had learned to trust God even when he did not understand. In the morning, he set out for the mountain of sacrifice with Isaac and two servants. Before leaving, Abraham split pieces of wood to make a fire for the burnt offering. Abraham planned to obey God. 3 days later, they neared the mountain. Stay here. Abraham told his servants, we will go and worship, and we will come back to you. Isaac carried the wood. Abraham carried fire and a knife. Where is the lamb for a burnt offering? Isaac asked. God will provide himself a lamb, Abraham replied. The two came to the exact place chosen by God. There, Abraham built an altar and arranged the wood to burn the sacrifice before God. Abraham had built many altars. Surely this one was the hardest ever to build. Abraham tied Isaac up and placed his beloved son on the altar. Was Abraham really going to obey God and sacrifice his dear Isaac, his only son? Yes, the knife blade glinted as Abraham raised it high. His heart may have been breaking, but Abraham knew he must obey God. Stop! The angel of the Lord shouted. Now I know you fear God. You have not held back your son, your only son, from me. Seeing a ram in the bushes, Abraham untied Isaac and sacrificed the ram instead. Perhaps Isaac thought, God did provide just as my father said. While father and son worshipped, the angel of the Lord spoke to Abraham. In your children, all nations shall be blessed because you obeyed. Someday, Jesus would be born through Abraham's descendants. Abraham and Isaac returned home. Sometime later, sadness came. Sarah died. Abraham had lost his wife, and Isaac had lost his mother. After the funeral, Abraham sent his chief servant to look for a wife for Isaac. The servant went to their old homeland to find a wife among Abraham's relatives. The servant asked God for a sign. Let the girl who offers water for my camels be the right one for Isaac. Immediately, Rebekah offered to give them water. She was one of Abraham's relatives. The servant knew God had answered his prayer. Rebekah left her family to marry Isaac. She comforted him after his mother died. How Isaac loved her. God tests Abraham's love. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 22 to 24. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much He sent His Son Jesus to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask him to forgive your sins, he will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is Jacob the Deceiver. Did God ever send a baby to your family? How exciting! Isaac and Rebecca must have been doubly joyful. God was going to give them twins. The baby struggled inside Rebecca. When she prayed, God said her two sons would lead two nations, and the younger one would be greater. Usually, the firstborn was greater. At last, the babies were born. The twins were not alike. Esau, the older boy, was very hairy and grew up to be a skillful hunter. Jacob was smooth-skinned and liked working around home. Father Isaac loved Esau best. Mother favored Jacob. One day, Esau was hungry. "Give me food," he told Jacob. "Sell me your birthright," demanded Jacob. Esau did not care about God's promises to the firstborn. He made a deal with Jacob. Now, Jacob would head the family when their father died. God spoke to Isaac one night.
"I am the God of your father, Abraham. I am with you. I will bless your descendants."
Although Isaac worshipped God, his son Esau married two wives from the Hittites, a people who didn't care about God. Isaac grew old.
"Please bring me fresh meat," he told Esau. "Then I will bless you."
This special blessing was from father to firstborn. Esau hurried out to hunt, but Rebekah had overheard.
She wanted Jacob to be blessed.
Rebecca had a plan. While she quickly cooked the food Isaac loved, Jacob put on Esau's clothes and put hairy animal skins on his hands and neck. Isaac did not see well. Perhaps they could deceive him. Jacob brought the food to Isaac.
"You sound like Jacob,"
Isaac said, "but your hands feel like Esau." After he had eaten the food, Isaac blessed the son kneeling before him. Just after Jacob left, Esau came to Isaac.
"Here's your food," he said.
Isaac knew he had been tricked.
"I cannot change the blessing," he cried.
Esau's heart filled with hatred. He decided to kill Jacob. Rebekah heard Esau's threats.
"Go to your uncle's house," she told Jacob,
"until your brother forgets what you have done." Isaac agreed that Jacob should seek a wife from his mother's family. So Jacob left home. That night, Jacob stopped to sleep with a stone for a pillow. Perhaps he was lonely, perhaps afraid, but he was not alone. God spoke to him in a wonderful dream.
"I am the God of your fathers, Abraham and Isaac. I am with you. I will give you this land. By your family, all the families of the earth shall be blessed."
After God spoke, Jacob awoke. He was afraid. Jacob's uncle Laban welcomed him. Jacob loved his cousin Rachel and served Laban 7 years so he could marry her. But on the wedding night, Laban cheated Jacob.
"This is Leah, not Rachel," Jacob complained.
"You tricked me."
"The oldest daughter must be married first," Laban said.
"Now marry Rachel also and serve me 7 more years.
Jacob agreed. Perhaps he remembered his own trickery towards Isaac and Esau. Jacob had 11 sons. As years passed, he longed to take his family back to Canaan. His parents were there. But so was Esau, who had vowed to kill him. Was it safe? One day, God told him to return. Jacob gathered his family and flocks to set out for home. What a trip it was! Esau came to meet Jacob with 400 men, but he didn't hurt Jacob. He ran to meet Jacob and gave him a big hug. Jacob and Esau were friends again, and Jacob was safely home. Jacob the Deceiver, a story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 25 to 33. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much He sent His Son Jesus to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Hey children, this is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is A Favorite Son Becomes a Slave. Isaac was very happy. His son Jacob was home. Even Esau welcomed the brother he once vowed to kill, but Jacob's sons were not happy because Joseph, their younger brother, was father's favorite. Joseph's brother became more angry when he told them his dreams. "My sheaf of grain stood tall, and my brother's sheaves bowed in honor," Joseph said. This dream meant Joseph would be more important than his brothers. In Joseph's second dream, the sun, moon, and stars bowed down to him. Even his father Jacob was angry at him for putting himself above his parents and brothers. One day, Jacob sent Joseph to the field where his brothers tended their flocks. His brothers saw him coming. "Let's kill this dreamer," they muttered. Joseph did not know the danger before him. Reuben, the oldest brother, disagreed.
"We must not shed blood," he said. "See, here's a pit. Let him die there."
Reuben planned to rescue Joseph at nightfall. When Joseph arrived, his brothers grabbed him and took off the colored coat Jacob had specially made for his favorite son. Then they threw him into the awful pit. While Reuben was absent, a caravan of camels drew near on their way to distant Egypt.
"Let's sell Joseph,"
cried Judah, his brother. The deal was made. They sold Joseph for 20 pieces of silver. Tearful and afraid, Joseph watched helplessly as the lurching camel led him away from his family and homeland.
"Is this Joseph's coat? It's bloody. We found it in the desert."
The cruel brothers allowed Jacob to believe a wild animal had killed his favorite son. Jacob tore his clothes and mourned. Nobody could comfort him. In Egypt, Joseph must have been afraid and lonely. Maybe he longed for home, but he could not escape. He was a slave in the house of Potiphar, an important Egyptian. Potiphar saw that Joseph always worked hard and could be trusted.
All you do turns out well,
Potiphar told Joseph one day.
God is with you. I want you to be my chief servant, in charge of all my business, and master of all my other servants.
God gave Potiphar good harvests and many riches because of Joseph. Now, an important man, Joseph still trusted and served God faithfully. But trouble came to Joseph. Potiphar's wife was a wicked woman. She asked Joseph to take place of her husband. Joseph refused. He would not sin against God by wronging Potiphar. When the woman tried to force him, he ran, but she caught and held his coat.
Your slave attacked me,
Potiphar's wife complained.
See, here's his coat.
Potiphar was angry. Maybe he knew his wife was lying, but he had to do something. What would he do? Potiphar put Joseph in prison. Although he was innocent, Joseph was not bitter or angry. Perhaps he was learning from his hardships that no matter where he was, if he honored God, God would honor him even in jail. A favorite son becomes a slave. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 37 and 39. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death. But God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is God Honors Joseph the Slave. Joseph was wrongly placed in prison by his former master Potiphar. In prison, Joseph was obedient and helpful. The warden trusted Joseph to organize prison life. Because God was with Joseph, prison became a better place for everybody. The king's baker and butler were in jail. "Why are you so sad?" Joseph asked them one day. "No one can show us what our dreams mean," the troubled man replied. "God can," Joseph said. "Tell me the dreams." "Your dream means that in 3 days you will be back in King Pharaoh's favor," Joseph told the butler. "Remember me and ask Pharaoh to free me." The baker's dream held bad news. "You will die in 3 days," Joseph said. Both dreams came true. But the butler forgot about Joseph until Pharaoh woke up troubled one day. "I've had a dream," he cried. None of his wise men could show him its meaning. Then the butler remembered Joseph in prison. He told Pharaoh about him. Pharaoh sent for Joseph immediately. "Your dream is a message from God," Joseph told the king. "Egypt will have 7 years of plenty, then 7 years of awful famine. Plan now to store food during the 7 good years. Joseph advised Pharaoh, "or your people will starve to death in the famine." "God is with you," Pharaoh declared. "You will take in charge in Egypt, second only to me." 7 years of plenty came, then 7 years of famine. Food was scarce everywhere, except in Egypt, where they had wisely stored huge supplies. In Joseph's far-off homeland, Jacob's family was starving. People from all countries went to Egypt to buy grain. "You must go too," Jacob commanded his sons, "or we will starve to death." Arriving in Egypt, the sons prepared to buy food. Jacob's sons bow low before lordly person in charge of Egypt. They did not recognize Joseph, their brother, but Joseph knew them. Joseph remembered his boyhood dreams. God had raised him above his brothers. Joseph was very wise. He spoke roughly and kept his brother Simeon hostage. "Take food, go home, and return with your youngest brother," he ordered. "Then I will know you are not spies." The brothers thought that God might be punishing them for selling Joseph as a slave many years before. Jacob and his sons were confused. "Our money was returned in the grain, and the ruler said we must bring Benjamin." Jacob would not let Benjamin go, but soon the food was used up. The brothers had to go back to Egypt. Benjamin went with them. When Joseph saw Benjamin, he ordered his servants to prepare a great feast. The brothers were invited. "Is your father alive and well?" Joseph asked. Perhaps he was thinking of how he could bring the whole family together. Joseph also wanted to know if his brothers were really sorry for their sin of many years before. After the banquet, he accused them of stealing. "To punish you, I will keep Benjamin as my slave." Joseph said,
"My Lord, take my life instead,"
begged Judah. Joseph knew that Judah, who had suggested selling Joseph, was truly changed. No longer able to hide his love for his family, Joseph sent all the Egyptians out. Then he began to weep.
"I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into Egypt."
Amazed and afraid, the brother said nothing. Joseph encouraged his brothers.
"God made me Lord in Egypt so I could save your lives in this famine. Go, bring my father. I will look after you."
Jacob and Joseph were reunited in Egypt, and the whole family lived there in peace and plenty. God honors Joseph the slave. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Genesis chapters 39 to 45. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. "Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins, so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen." Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children. Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is The Prince from the River. Prime Minister Joseph was dead. All Egypt shared his family's sadness. God had used Joseph the Hebrew to save the country from famine. He was a wise and beloved leader. Now he was gone. Over 300 long years passed. Joseph's people, the Hebrews, had become a mighty race within Egypt. The new Pharaoh feared the Hebrews might turn against him, so he made them all slaves. Pharaoh treated the Hebrews cruelly. He forced them to build great cities, but no matter how hard he worked them, the Hebrew slaves continued to grow in numbers. One day, a dreadful command came from Pharaoh. All newborn boys must be thrown into the river Nile. Wicked Pharaoh was determined to reduce the number of Hebrews. He would even murder babies. What can we do? One family must have wondered. They decided to put their child in the Nile River, but he would be inside a snug, watertight basket. Carrying its precious cargo, the small basket boat floated among the reeds. Whatever would happen to the tiny baby? From a distance, the baby sister watched the precious basket as it bobbed gently among the reeds. Suddenly, Pharaoh's daughter and her servants came to the river to bathe. There was no way to hide the basket. Perhaps they would walk by without seeing it.
Oh, a basket! There, in the reeds! I wonder what's inside!
Pharaoh's daughter commanded her servant to fetch the basket. When she opened it, the baby started to cry.
It's a Hebrew child!
The princess exclaimed.
Poor little thing, you're so beautiful!
Probably, Pharaoh's daughter talked to the baby the way many grown-ups do. She may even have said,
Oochie-coochie-coos!
In Egyptian, of course. God must have given wisdom to the baby sister. She ran to the Pharaoh's daughter.
Shall I find a Hebrew woman to look after the baby for you? Go ahead,
was the reply. Who do you think the girl ran to fetch?
Mother, come quickly! Oh, hurry!
Perhaps the girl didn't have time to explain. Together, the two raced back down the footpath. Back at the river, Pharaoh's daughter held out the baby.
Nurse him for me! I will pay you! Call him Moses!
Moses may be Egyptian for water son. So Moses was returned to his parents and home. They taught him to love God and the Hebrew people. Soon, he would live in the palace with Pharaoh's daughter. God, who saved his life, had a great future planned for baby Moses. The Prince from the River. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Exodus chapter 2. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on a cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is Goodbye, Pharaoh. Pharaoh was angry. God had commanded him through Moses to let the Israelite slaves leave Egypt. He refused.
Work them harder,
Pharaoh ordered his slave masters. Now things were even worse for the Israelites.
Gather your own straw. We won't provide it any longer, but make the same number of bricks.
Those were Pharaoh's new orders. The taskmasters whipped some slaves because they didn't have time to gather straw and still make enough bricks. The people blamed Moses and Aaron for their troubles. Moses found a place to pray.
Oh Lord,
he cried.
You have not rescued your people at all.
I am the Lord, and I will bring you out,
God answered. Then God sent Moses and Aaron back to Pharaoh. When the mighty ruler asked God's servants for a sign from God, Aaron's rod turned into a slithering snake.
Call my magicians,
Pharaoh roared. When the Egyptian magicians threw down their rods, each rod became a snake also. But Aaron's rod swallowed the others. Still, Pharaoh refused to let the people go. Next morning, Moses and Aaron met Pharaoh at the river. When Aaron held out his rod, God turned the water into blood. Fish died. People couldn't drink it. But Pharaoh hardened his heart. He would not let the Israelites leave Egypt. Again, Moses told Pharaoh to let God's people go. Pharaoh refused again. God sent another plague. All of Egypt was filled with frogs. Every house, every room, even the cooking ovens were overrun with frogs.
pray for me that God will remove the frogs,"
Pharaoh pleaded,
"and I will let your people go."
But when the frogs were gone, Pharaoh changed his mind. He would not free the slaves.
God then sent billions of tiny bugs called lice, every person and beast each from their bites, but Pharaoh would not give in to God.
Next, God sent flies, swarms of them. God sent disease to kill the Egyptians' livestock.
God sent painful boils. People suffered terribly. Still, Pharaoh resisted God.
After the plague of boils, God sent hordes of locusts. The locusts ate every green plant in the land.
Then God sent 3 days of complete darkness, but stubborn Pharaoh would not free the Israelites.
"I will send one more plague," God warned.
"About midnight, all the firstborn of man and beast will die."
God told the Israelites their firstborn would be saved if they placed lamb's blood on their doorposts.
At midnight, a great cry arose in Egypt. Death had struck. At least one person had died in every house.
"Get out!"
Pharaoh begged Moses.
"Go serve the Lord!"
Quickly, God's people marched beyond Egypt's border.
God told Moses to remember the Passover night because the angel of God had passed over the Israelites' homes and struck Pharaoh and his people.
After 430 years in Egypt, God's people were now free.
God led them in a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night.
But Pharaoh was not finished with the Israelites. Again, he forgot God. Again, he changed his mind. Gathering his army, he went after the slaves. Soon, he had them trapped between the cliffs and the sea.
"The Lord shall fight for you,"
Moses said. Moses went forward to the water's edge and stretched out his arm.
A great miracle happened. God opened a path through the water. The people crossed safely.
Then Pharaoh's army galloped into the Red Sea.
"Now we'll catch them,"
the soldiers thought. But God closed the waters. Egypt's powerful army was swallowed up. Now Pharaoh knew that Israel's God was Lord over all.
Goodbye, Pharaoh. A story from God's Word, the Bible, is found in Exodus chapters 4 to 15. "The entrance of your words gives light." Psalm 119, verse 130. The end.
This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death, but God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. "Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins. so that I can have new life now, and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children! Good day, children. This is Sir O. It's time for another wonderful story. The title of our story for today is The Prince Becomes a Shepherd. One day, Moses saw an Egyptian beating a Hebrew slave. Though Moses had been raised and educated as a prince in Pharaoh's palace, he too was a Hebrew. He had to help the slave. Glancing around to make sure nobody was watching, Moses attacked the cruel slave master. In the fight which followed, Moses killed the Egyptian. Quickly, he buried the body. The next day, Moses saw two Hebrews fighting. He tried to stop them. One said, "Will you kill me as you killed the Egyptian?" Moses was afraid. Everybody knew about yesterday. Pharaoh knew. Moses had to escape. He went to a country called Midian. While Moses rested by a well, the seven daughters of the priest of Midian filled the troughs to water their father's flock. Other shepherds tried to push them aside. Moses protected and helped the women.
"You're home early!"
Reuel, the girl's father, exclaimed. When the girls explained why, he said,
"Bring the man here."
Moses lived with Reuel, who was also called Jethro. Later, Moses married Reuel's oldest daughter. Back in Egypt, Pharaoh died. God's people, the Hebrews, were still slaves. How they groaned in their suffering! How they prayed for God's help! God heard their prayers. Moses did not know it, but God planned to use him to help the enslaved Hebrews. 40 years had passed since Moses left Egypt. He was shepherd of Reuel's flock, but he must have missed his own people in Egypt. One day, Moses noticed a nearby bush on fire, but the fire did not burn the bush. Moses decided to find out why. As Moses approached, God called to him out of the bush,
"Moses!"
"Here I am," said Moses.
Don't get too close, God said. Take off your sandals, because the place where you stand is holy ground. I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people out of Egypt, God said.
But Moses was afraid to go. Then God showed Moses his great power. He turned Moses' rod into a serpent. When Moses picked up the serpent by the tail, it became a rod once more. God gave another sign.
Put your hand on your chest, he commanded.
Moses did so. His hand turned white with leprosy. When he did it again, his hand was healed. Moses still objected.
I don't speak well,
he told God. God became angry.
I'll use Aaron, your brother, to speak the words you tell him, he said.
Moses returned to Jethro, packed his belongings, and left for Egypt. God led Moses' brother Aaron to meet Moses in the mountains. Moses told Aaron all about God's plan to set the Hebrew people free from the Egyptians. Together, they carried the news to the Hebrew leaders. When Moses showed the signs to the Hebrew elders, they knew God would help them. Together, they bowed and worshiped. Bravely, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh.
God says, "Let my people go," they told him. I will not let Israel go,
Pharaoh answered. He would not obey God. God would have to use his great power to change Pharaoh's mind. The prince becomes a shepherd. A story from God's word, the Bible, is found in Exodus chapters 2-5. The entrance of your words gives light. Psalm 119, verse 130. The end. This Bible story tells us about our wonderful God who made us and who wants us to know Him. God knows we have done bad things, which He calls sin. The punishment for sin is death. But God loves us so much, He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross and be punished for our sins. Then Jesus came back to life and went home to heaven. If you believe in Jesus and ask Him to forgive your sins, He will do it. He will come and live in you now, and you will live with Him forever. If you want to turn from your sins, say this to God. Dear God, I believe that Jesus died for me and now lives again. Please come into my life and forgive my sins, so that I can have new life now and one day go to be with you forever. Help me to live for you as your child. Amen. Read the Bible and talk with God every day. John chapter 3, verse 16. Did you like our story for today? Well, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Ideas by Sir O, and click the notification bell for more stories. And don't forget to share this to your friends and your loved ones. And if you have comments, please go to the comment section below. Once again, this is your Sir O. Thank you so much and have a good day. Bye, children.